It is often said that you cannot manage what you cannot measure, and this is very, very true in the case of climate change and CO2 emissions. Carbon capture and sequestration by forests is one of the planet's free carbon dioxide management systems, but it's been severely diminished by deforestation. That deforestation is ongoing and is a current problem, as we all well know, from the fires now burning in the Amazon. One way to reverse deforestation is to put a price on forest carbon sequestration, allowing restoration and conservation to proceed via financial carbon market mechanisms. These markets, however, so far have not impacted rates of deforestation appreciably. California created the cap and trade legislation, of which forest carbon sequestration is a key component, reducing CO2 emissions, comprising 70% plus of the offsets issued to date. This forest carbon offset program is managed by the California Air Resources Board and the Climate Action Reserve, resulting in what we refer to herein as the CARB-CAR protocol. We wanted to look very closely at the CARB-CAR protocol process and results to evaluate how well the system measures the net amount of CO2 being sequestered in forests, and ultimately to determine if this legislative program is efficacious in its climate change policy management objectives. The net amount of carbon that remains in the forest is a key metric of importance, and that net amount, or the net ecosystem exchange of carbon, is the balance between the amount of carbon given off during respiration to the atmosphere and the amount taken up by the forest during photosynthesis. It's that difference that determines whether the forest is a net sink or a net source of CO2. We investigated the question of how well the CARB-CAR protocol works by comparing the results of that protocol with an independent method of forest carbon accounting called eddy covariance. Eddy covariance is based on direct measurement of molecular carbon dioxide as flux in the forest, resulting in net ecosystem exchange, or NEE. Eddy covariance methods are very well known and have been deployed across the planet in over 150 locations over the past decade. And eddy covariance provides an important metric of net ecosystem exchange across regions, as well as a monitor for climate change impacts on forests. In contrast, the CARB-CAR approach relies on biometric data based on physical measurement of trees, and they make use of model simulations of tree growth to determine ultimately the net ecosystem exchange in the CARB offset system. No direct CO2 measurements are made in this system. We first studied a single site where both methods were deployed. The CARB-CAR approach was not comparable with the measurements based on the eddy covariance approach, and the data for the CARB-CAR protocol did not reflect known natural patterns of photosynthesis or respiration dynamics. The results of that part of the investigation framed out our approach to examine the larger samples of data for both the CARB-CAR and the eddy covariance approach. We also found, however, that the two data sets were statistically very, very different when compared as populations, CARB-CAR being one and the NEE being the other. We then searched to see what areas of the two data sets might be in agreement by looking at the data across overlapping time intervals. And all of those tests told us that there's a good chance the CARB-CAR results are not reflective of the natural forest carbon processes, raising overall a red flag and providing criteria for invalidation. We draw four major conclusions from the study. One is that CARB-CAR protocols do not employ complete carbon accounting methods. Two, the data do not reflect natural patterns of carbon sequestration based on field data for net ecosystem exchange. Three, CARB-CAR data are invalid based on CARB's own invalidation criteria, and four, that related protocols such as the Verified Carbon Standard, or VCS, are not likely to render accurate results. This is an important point since VCS protocol covers many forest projects around the planet, including those now in Brazil. Broadly, the lesson learned is that everyone should understand that claims of emission decrease are not the same as verifying the actual curtailment of emissions at the site. They can only be verified by direct CO2 measurement. And moreover, in the case of CARB, this is a potentially vital U.S. program that has big implications for how the U.S. manages its climate policy now and going forward under climate change conditions. We recommend that whether they're governments or individuals or corporations, for voluntary or compliance purposes, all consumers should demand that claims of forest carbon storage or sequestration must be validated by direct and independent measurement. For example, this applies to carbon footprint calculations for air travel and the offsets that are offered to neutralize those emissions. This also applies to cuts in emissions mandated or desired by corporate and government entities. And it also applies to large-scale policies such as the Paris Agreement and the RED program. Simply stated, the CARB-CAR protocol system is not up to the task of providing the accuracy and the type of precision that we really need. But we are not advocating throwing out the CARB-CAR system. I believe that the next step is collaboration between the CARB process and community and the net ecosystem exchange research communities. That should be a high priority for the state of California and for the U.S. Right now, voluntary and compliance markets have different pricing, but they're all bound by the same estimation protocols. However, once you measure directly and measure the same, then the gap disappears, and we have a very effective, standardized, and harmonized system for forest carbon transactions. With that measurement system, we now have the opportunity to put a fundamental price on forest carbon. This study also reveals the enormous value of existing eddy covariance networks in the U.S. For example, NEON, the National Ecological Observatory Network, and Ameriflux are programs of CO2 sensor networks across the U.S. These are underutilized at the moment for carbon management, but they are, in my view, absolutely critical to have a U.S. program that provides verifiable information about carbon storage management across the U.S. We must have a verifiable, direct measurement system if we want to have an effective climate change policy that really makes a difference. And for forests, that's a very, very big opportunity of about 1 to 2 billion hectares, reaching from the Amazon to the heart of the African Congo Basin.